benchmarking of DFT codes. I will ask you something. Think about the very first time you learned to do a DFT calculation, each of you. I will give you a few seconds to search your memory. When was this, and how much effort did it take you? I will ask you to share your memories with us. When was your first DFT calculation, and how much effort did it take you?
That was an X-alpha calculation as a PhD student in 1980, perhaps.
1980?
And yeah. it was about ferrocene. And the reason was Hartree Fock couldn't do it. I mean, the bond distance, the geometry. And X-alpha could. And, you know, we were, how to say, massively puzzled why it could and Hartree Fock couldn't.
And how much time did it take you to learn how to do this calculation?
I never managed.
How many competitors did you have?
I was very confused about this, how to say, exchange thing and Slater hole. And I was vastly confused.
Yeah. Okay.
I will switch to someone else. Let's see. Here, perhaps, front row seats are always dangerous. Matteo, when did you do your first DFT calculation?
Well, 10 years ago, calculation for a hydrogen molecule, plain wave code.
And how much time did it take you to learn this?
Well, hydrogen was relatively simple, but then, okay, when you start to deal with crystalline systems or complicated compounds, it takes hours to master the different options and also the limitation of DFT.
Hours. Mm-hmm. How many people at that time would have been able to do the same calculation over the world?
I have no idea. No, okay.
Just order of magnitude. Thousands. And back in 1980, how many people would have been able to do that same X-alpha calculation?
Very few.
So I hear something that I was more or less expecting. Very few people could do it in 1980. Thousands of people, probably even much more, could do it 10 years ago. Actually, today, almost everybody can do a DFT calculation. It has become so easy. And that's giving us problems as a community, because people can also easily misuse it. To that extent that I've met experimentalists that told me, I don't believe anything from DFT because you can produce any number you want. And I can't blame these people for thinking about it that way, because if you look in the literature, I show here some very simple graph, a graph for an innocent material, silicon, an innocent property, lattice parameter, with a standard functional, PBE, all published DFT calculations as a function of the year of publication. And you see what these experimental people mean? Scatter. Well, it's not dramatic. If you look at the axis, the vertical axis, these numbers are, the scatter is not too large. But if you have these kind of problems already for very simple materials and very simple properties, how much worse could the problem be if you look at more complicated things? I've also met different experimentalists that told me just the opposite. They said, well, you are lucky with your calculations. That's quantum physics. You have the real thing. You don't have to worry about error bars. Well, these people were a bit too confident, so they were forgetting that we are dealing with a particular exchange correlation functional and that we never can get closer to experiment than our functional allows. So they were having too much confidence in the accuracy of DFT, while there are people that are worried by the limited precision of our present DFT calculations. So to summarize, I have at my left-hand side, the people who don't have confidence in DFT. At my right-hand side, you have the people who believe in it too much, and everything in between. I think it's a responsibility of our community that we should give these both extremes of people the right information. numbers, really data that can convince them what they can rightfully expect from our DFT predictions. And it's important that we do that as a community, because if we don't do it, others will do it in our place. There is a nice example in quantum chemistry, a Jack's paper from earlier this year, where a group without a particular theoretical background measured the free energy during a particular reaction and then took a lot of quantum theory tools and tried to reproduce these free energies and found that you can get any value you want. And that has stirred a large debate in the quantum chemistry community. Well, how well chosen were these methods? Were the calculations done right? Okay, well, I'm not in the position to judge on that debate. But the mere fact that that debate is there, that people from outside the theoretical community can start challenging us and pointing us to the fact, well, are you really sure that you can predict meaningful things? That is something we have to be aware of. So let's better test these things ourselves rather than having to answer to people who did these tests and challenge us. So we want to benchmark. How are we going to tackle that problem? I need a benchmark set, a set of materials that we all agree on and for which we will run calculations. That set should preferably be not a very large set, because we want to do our calculations in a meaningful amount of time. That set should preferably be a set for which there are also experimental data available. That's not necessary if you want to examine precision, but if you would like to examine accuracy, you need comparison to experiments. If you have in mind that you also want to test PAW sets or pseudopotential sets, then it's best to have every element of the periodic table represented in that set. So that's why we settle down to a minimal set that has all that satisfies all these requirements, the 71 elements from the periodic table that you see there. No lanthanides and actinides, a little compromise to save some time. Then you want to apply DFT codes to this benchmark set. And then you immediately run into the problem, well, I'm not an expert on many DFT codes, I can handle a few of them, but we want to test many of them. So we need experts. We need people who are really comfortable with a particular code and can use it in the best possible way and find the final values for that particular code. So we searched around and tried to form a group of people who were willing to take that challenge. And we found many of them. So the number is not completely well determined, but plus or minus a few, we have a group of 62 people who collaborated on this large benchmark test. How do you set all noses in the same direction if you are working with such a group of people? So we have to make some good agreements on how we will approach the calculations. And the most fundamental agreements are the ones that you see listed here. We decided to do only scalar relativistic calculations, even for the heavy elements that are in the set, only scalar relativistic calculations. Because our goal is not to come as close as possible to experiment, we want to compare two different codes. And at least at the level of scalar relativity, the codes more or less agree on the schemes they use. For spin orbit, that's an entirely different issue. I wish we would have agreed on the separation between what we consider core electrons and what we consider to be valence electrons. We didn't. And probably some of the deviations that are left in the set will be because not all codes use the same division. It will not matter too much, but part of the diversity will be due to this. And certainly, we would like to avoid any numerical issues. So we take basis sets that are as large as you can imagine, K-meshes that are as dense as you can imagine, so really crazy values sometimes, but we can afford that. It's only for 71 materials, so you can really exclude numerical imperfections in that way. Then we took for every of these materials one volume that we know is close to the expected equilibrium volume. It doesn't need to have spot on, just one value. And we take a crystal structure for the ground state crystal structure with that particular volume, make a SIF file for that, and now tell the people, take 6 other volumes in steps of 2% below and above that reference volume, and just blow up or shrink your crystal. No C over A optimization, no optimization of atomic positions, just a frozen expansion reduction of that reference volume to make sure that everybody has exactly the same 7 structures. Calculate with your method the total energy for all of these structures. You get these 7 data points, fit a Birch-Murdigan equation through it, and you condense in 4 numbers, the 4 fit parameters of the Birch-Murdigan equation, what is the result of that code for that particular material. That you do not for one code, but for 2 codes, and you compare now these 2 Birch-Murdigan fits. You bring them down to the same ground level, and then you measure the area in between and normalize it. That is the number which we call delta for a particular element, for a particular material. If you do that, for instance, for FCC copper, say with VASP and with Wien2K, you find a delta for copper which is 1.8 millielectron volt per atom. That number expresses the difference between these 2 codes. For one material, so you have to average this over the entire set. Here you see that table that gives all these individual deltas for VASP versus Wien2K. And if you average, it's 0.4 millielectron volt per atom. So that expresses the difference between VASP on average with Wien2K on average in one single number. And that you do now with our group of 62 people for a lot of different codes and libraries, about 35 if I remember well. And you can plot this in such a table where all numbers you see is such an average delta between 2 different setups. If you see green, it's a small number. If you see red, it's a large number. But what is small and large? We have no feeling yet for what the numerical value of these deltas mean. So we have to have a handle on what do we call a small delta. And one way to do that is take 3 codes that use the same formalism. In this case, all electron codes that use the APW plus LO basis set. And don't try to make the best possible calculation, but agree within these 3 codes on common settings, which is possible because it's really the same underlying method. And observe what are the deltas you get for a particular material, in this case HCP osmium. And you get something that is 0.2. So that is a small delta. These codes must cluster together, must give results that are very comparable, so such deltas are really small. If you want to convince yourself by looking at observable properties, you see the equilibrium volume, bulk modulus, and pressure derivative of the bulk modulus for HCP osmium, and the deviations are really only in a very right-hand side digit. So 0.2, something of that order of magnitude, is very small. If we compare all electron codes in the set, and now not only for HCP osmium, but for everything, and not with common settings, but everybody trying to get as precise as you can, then we have cross-correlations of delta which are between 0.1 and 0.9. Here in the right-hand column, you see the average of, say, exciting with respect to the 5 other all-electron codes is 0.5. And all these averages are close together. So on average, 0.6, that is a small deviation still between all electron codes. You could even get an argument from experiments. If you look at very high quality experiments for 3 elemental materials, copper, silver and gold, and you look at the error bars that they have in the best possible experiments for these 3 materials, and convert that into a delta value, then you get again this 0.2. So something between 0.2, 1, that is a small delta. The number turns out not to be very sensitive. You can easily go up to a delta of 2. And so our rule of thumb is two methods that have an average deviation between 1 and 2 millielectron volts per atom, these two methods can be considered to be identical, at least for all practical purposes. Knowing that, let's now investigate our table a little bit deeper. I compare all the all-electron methods, which you saw already, with PAW methods. And the numbers you see here and at the bottom side of the slide, this 1 is the average delta of the GBrV12 set in Abinit with respect to these 6 all-electron codes. And you see 1, 1.4, 1.6, 0.6, same order of magnitude, between 1 and 2 millielectron volt per atom. So the set of modern PAW potentials have the same quality as all-electron calculations. Similar story for ultra-soft pseudopotentials, 1.1, 0.7, 0.5. Modern ultra-soft pseudopotential sets have a delta of the same quality as all-electron methods. If you look at an older ultra-soft pseudopotential set, a calculation done with the DACAPO code using a potential set using the very first Vanderbilt scheme, then this delta is much larger. That's a deviating situation. That's a pseudopotential set that is clearly off. You should not use that any longer. And even the norm-conserving pseudopotential sets, which you maybe would expect to be deviating more than the ultra-soft ones. No, for the modern versions, the numbers are 2.2, 1.2, even down to 1. So also the best norm-conserving pseudopotential sets are as good as all-electron calculations. There has been a progress over time. So I pointed already to an old set that has a different, that has a higher delta than the younger sets. If you plot for some codes that have a history of PAW potentials or pseudopotentials, a history over time, then you see that there has been progress. CASTEP with their first ultra-soft set has a delta of 7.7, and that progressively went down to 0.7 with the present set. VASP with the 2011 PAW potentials had a delta of 2. With the most recent set, it's 0.6. So there has been a steady increase in the precision of our methods. But that increase, this good agreement, that didn't come spontaneously. It is there if you remove all human errors. But these human errors did happen. That's a situation we often had in the discussions with all our collaborators. I have a few elements that are deviating. Where does it come from? People reinvestigate and often they find, yes, indeed, I made an input mistake. Or there was some default setting that we thought was okay, but indeed, if you look closer, the default was for that particular case not good enough. So people had to tune and tweak their codes, always going into the direction of higher precision. And when everybody did that, only then you have this good overall agreement. I will illustrate that with one specific case, which was the oxygen 2 dimeric crystal. You see the delta values for this oxygen crystal with the 6 all-electron methods. And then the corresponding delta for VASP with the 2011 PAW set. And these VASP data are off. How was that possible? Well, this was a calculation we did initially ourselves. We go to the VASP people and they tell us, of course, you know that for a dimeric crystal, you have to take the hard potential, not the soft one. We say, no, we just did what was in the manual. You have a table of recommended PAW potentials, and for oxygen, it's the soft one. Yes, but not for dimeric crystals. So there is now an extra line in the manual. People are now informed that this is a mistake they can avoid. And if you do that, if you take the hard potential, the delta for VASP is even for oxygen again low. So this kind of stories, either in manuals or in default settings, that happened many, many times. And it helped, I think, to improve the general quality of our documentations and our codes. In this big matrix, it sometimes happens that you can look at one single PAW set that is used in two different codes. And we have one, this GPOW09 set, that is used both in ABINIT and in GPOW. So I will zoom in to the section where they cross. And what do you see? Well, if you compare ABINIT with respect to GPOW for this particular set, you find the same type of deviation as for the all-electron codes. If you compare it with other methods, the deviation is slightly larger. So, which shows that this 0.6 is really a good number for the remaining numerical noise that you apparently can never get rid of. The total number of calculations in this work has totals to 16,555. And thanks to all these individual DFT calculations, I think we can say now that all these DFT codes have a kind of quality approval. The 62 people that are collaborating in this project, they have received last week what is probably the final draft of the paper for last detailed comments. The title will be The Khon-Sham Equation of State for Elemental Solids, a Solved Problem, because I think we really have now the final DFT answers for them with PBE. I would have loved to show you the author list together with the abstract of that paper, but the list is a little bit long, so it doesn't fit on one page. The abstract is only at page 2. I wonder what the people from the journal will think about that. One last slide about how you can proceed with this work now. It's clear that if we want to have even more information, we will need to study more properties. And this was just equation of state. What happens if you would compare band gaps or electronic properties or phonons? So that is a way where you can improve. Having only the elemental crystals, that was good for the pseudopotential testing, but it is also a limitation. Will a potential that is fine in an elementary material also be fine if you use it in an oxide? You better have some binary oxides in your set as well, for instance. You will hear from Andres in the next talk what happens if you hunt for full precision, if you try to get away of this remaining noise. And I didn't talk about accuracy here, that's a different story. But one thing we realized during this work is that if you want to address precision and if you want to address accuracy, you cannot do that with the same benchmark set. So these tracks will probably separate and we will have to develop different benchmark sets for each of the two aspects. That's a lot of work that is still need to be done, work from the entire community. And I give it as a suggestion, while we are all here, maybe we should think about funding possibilities for such a community project. And this is something many people now did in the margin of other things, but if you want to tackle this in a structural way, a common project would be probably more ideal. So that's it. If you want to look at all the data, you can find them at the website there on top. If you want to download the slides, you find them here. And in a few days, the screencast of this talk should be available on YouTube on this address. Thanks for your attention.